Welcome to today's CSER session on teaching digital tech in an unplugged class. I am your host. I'm your presenter today. My name is Laura Ferguson and I work with the University of Adelaide in the CSER team. And I'm excited to be going through some ideas today of how we can teach digital tech in a classroom with either limited access to devices or computers, or just some other ideas and different ways of doing that. Some of you might not be familiar with Zoom, so I'll just do a quick overview. If you do have any tech questions, pop them in the chat and we can help you troubleshoot them as we go. As you can see, they just leave your microphone on mute. And as I've said, just use the chat to interact. And there are some reactions there as well. You can always do like a thumbs up or a wave if there's something that we talk about that you don't want to write in the chat, but you just want to give a reaction for that one. So I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we work and live and recognise their continuing connection to land, water and community. I pay respect to elders past, present and emerging. And here in Brisbane, where I am located, the custodians of the land are the Turrbal and Yarraga people. So today, just a quick overview of what we're doing, so how and why to teach these digital tech unplugged, how that connects to the curriculum, both cross-curricular in other learning areas, but also, of course, in our digital technology. Some learning activity ideas, and we can build on those as we go through some thinking activities and some resources, both from CSER and also external resources that can help you find out more. So, as I said, I am here in steamy, hot, stormy Brisbane today. I would like to invite you to use this map on the screen and you can use the annotating tools by either putting a stamp on it, might be a star. Oh, I can see one has popped up already, a little love heart. Thank you. I'm going to guess that might be Celia. Or you can write some text to say where you are. So you can go up to the annotate tool and you can either select some text or a little stamp. So that's me there in Brisbane. Great, so I can see some more little stamps popping up. Wonderful, so a bit of a mix from the East Coast there. Wonderful, so a nice mixture there of where everyone is from. Lauren, did you get a chance to take a screenshot there? Oh, I don't know what that one's doing. All right, so.
Yeah, sorry, I did.
Sorry, thank you. Wonderful. So some of you may or may not be familiar with our resources with the CSER Digital Technologies program. Feel free to give a reaction, a thumbs up or a wave to let us know if you are familiar, but we do have some awesome resources coming along there. And I might bear with me. I just saw that there was annotation there. I'll just reshare. better. We didn't want our little stamps on all of our slides. So yeah, so we of course have our amazing MOOCs, our massive open online courses available, our digital lending library where you can borrow equipment from us and it gets delivered to you to use in school for a term or a period of time. We have our professional learning, which is of course what we're building on today, and we're continually evolving and building more and more of those resources alongside where it says resources there. We're really, you know, if nothing else, this year has shown us lots of different ways of working, so we are continuing to build on those resources for families or working from home. So highly recommend checking out the resources section there. This one here, so this is from the Computer Science Education Project, where it'll tell you a little bit about working unplugged.
Computer Science Unplugged is a free collection of activities that expose students to ideas from computer science without using computers. This removes the barrier of having to learn to program or even own a computer before you can find out if computer science is your thing. Computer Science Unplugged uses kinesthetic activities that enable young students to physically engage with concepts, like this parallel sorting network, where students follow a simple rule, comparing numbers when they meet at a box and ending up in sorted order. After doing the physical activity, they can explore the concept through discussion and exercises. This activity can be done by a group of six students or a whole class. Another activity is the card flip magic trick, which is a memory trick that impresses students of all ages. It's based on a forward error correction code that children can usually figure out for themselves. And again, once they have understood the concept, there are many variations and questions to explore. Binary numbers can be explored using just a set of cards, which provide the scaffolding to convert numbers and find patterns in this black and white number system. There's even a pop music video where messages are coded as binary numbers into the tune and the dancing. There are many algorithms to explore. In this case, students use balance scales to compare two identical looking weights at a time in order to get them ordered from lightest to heaviest. Binary search and the idea of divide and conquer algorithms can be explored using ping pong balls hidden under cups. Computer Science Unplugged has several activities about encryption, especially how secure communication can happen on an insecure network. The resources also include a picture book where Santa uses a divide and conquer algorithm to find a pair of dirty socks that has been accidentally wrapped up with a gift. Image representation is explored with oversized pixels, and students can press them for efficient transmission. Like most of the activities, there are paper-based exercises to follow up, as well as a growing number of computer-based activities. There are many more activities, including getting familiar with the concept of finite state automata by running around the playground, and exploring issues of routing and deadlock using fruit. Computer Science Unplugged is used in many countries around the world, and even in virtual worlds. It is supported by a team of international translators, advisors, and advocates. It has been translated into many languages, and the resources and text are freely available for teachers and presenters to adapt for their own context. Computer Science Unplugged is about empowering students to explore the great ideas that are hidden in the technologies that have become so commonplace that they're taken for granted. But most of all, it provides an easy and fun way to engage with students around the topic of computer science.
So I thought that was a really good video because it just showed, it talked about, you know, lots of different ways that we can really engage the students in these, you know, changing times. And, you know, it's not just the focus on the device and the technology, but really having that opportunity to explore some of those key concepts. So let's have a little look at where we're at. So, as I mentioned before, learning at home, I'm sure it's been interesting for everyone this year. But I think, as I said before, it has opened up a range of opportunities of things that we can do. So in terms of working unplugged, of course, teaching online, you know, a lot of families at home aren't going to have the same sort of devices that we have at school. So to be able to incorporate some of those key concepts in a home environment is a really exciting opportunity, I think. But also for students who work remotely or socially distanced all the time, it's great for them to still be able to engage in that curriculum. I will explore later on some connection across the curriculum in other subject areas. And of course, even in, you know, metro schools close to the city, some of those schools sometimes do have issues with access to resources, or it might be just unreliable internet or not enough computers and digital equipment to share around. Of course, we do have our CSER lending library available, but it is an ongoing issue in schools across the nation. What I find exciting about Teaching Unplugged is kids can do things hands-on. They can play games, they can do puzzles, they can create and use recycled materials and paper to really just cement that idea of what we're trying to focus on before then moving on to that more abstract work where, you know, whether it's block coding or writing an algorithm or creating a digital system. It means that the students have really explored that idea first, and then they can get stuck into the equipment. And also, I think it's really fun to mix it up and be able to do things with paper and really that hands-on games and get out of the classroom and, you know, really step things out and be a robot and take on that role. So I'm going to just talk about a few little ideas of some key concepts from the digital technologies curriculum and how that might be explored in a classroom in an unplugged scenario. So first off, I thought it was interesting to have a look at exploring binary. So this is straight out of the Australian curriculum. This is off the Australian Computing Academy website. Now I have blocked out the early years because I'll look at them later on as an example. They don't need to know, really be exploring binary as such in that specific context yet until they start to unpack it in years 5 and 6 and upwards. So bit of text here, but I thought I've just sort of given a couple of ideas. So one way of doing that is acting it out. So asking students to just hold up cards with dots on them, and they can practice the idea of flipping them over. So it's black on one side. So it's that idea of on or a one, or flipping it over so that the dot shows up, and then it's that idea of being off or a zero. I've put the link there for an example of how that activity might be explored. So that's through the CS Unplugged website. Another way that students can explore that idea of binary is looking at a whole different range of codes, such as Morse code, and kids love writing those secret messages and that idea of a secret language. So again, I've put the example link here where students can work out what the binary is for each individual letter of the alphabet. You can see there's an image there that sort of highlights how that might look in the classroom. And it can start off something as very simple as that picture actually aligns with the binary bracelets, the third example there. But kids can write a message, or they can just practice writing their name and actually understanding how something as simple as dots or ones and zeros, which is computer language, and how that can really be encoded and decoded to actually mean something to them who don't speak computer language. And then, as I said, yeah, that idea of a binary bracelet through code.org, just having a little play with those letters and aligning it to something that's quite familiar to them. We all sort of learn to code just by learning the letters of the alphabet when we're first learning to read. So making that connection to something that they're already building confidence in and aligning it to binary, I think, is a clever way of really introducing it there. So here I have mentioned, as I said before, I've got more of the early years here. So just that idea of recognising and exploring patterns and understanding that it might represent that data, not necessarily in numbers, but like in a pictogram, like I have a picture here, just showing, you know, that idea of collecting data and it might be their favourite fruit, or what fruit did you bring for fruit or brain break today, or eye colour, or how they travelled to school perhaps. This is something that a lot of classes do anyway as part of their maths and science, is that idea of collecting data, but to make that connection, to start to represent that data in different ways, whether it's in a picture or in a symbol or in a different type of diagram here, like a graph or a table, introduces them and builds that understanding leading up to when they start to explore binary, which can be something completely different to what they've explored previously. And that's a little idea, as I mentioned, about that. I didn't mention favorite ice cream flavor. That's always a fun one. And as I mentioned, it can also be done with like colored paper or counters. You could have laminated sheets with graphs or tables set out, and the students can survey each other or ask each other and collect that idea and represent it with colored paper or counters, or as I said, a pictograph. Can also be done with something as fun as Lego. And I'm sure some of our CSER project officers are loving this, you know, that idea of representing it. How might we sort that Lego? How might we represent it? And it might be putting it together in colours, or it might be the brick size, and then building on that and saying, oh, well, how did that group actually sort their data, and how did they put it together in that different way? Are we going to arrange it into a graph, or what type of graph might that be? And those are all concepts that are part of that digital technologies curriculum, is collecting data. We have data, and what do we then do with that data once we have it? Good old algorithms. Something that really has so many opportunities, I think, really exciting ways of unpacking this and having students understand that algorithms, you know, we're really just looking at a sequence of steps and decisions to solve a digital problem, and looking at it in different ways and exploring that across the curriculum means that they have opportunities to really dig deeper and really get that depth of knowledge when it comes to looking at it in a digital technologies context. So a fun one here is Dancy Party. So you can have a range of instructions that students can pick and choose, and they can be like little printed out ones or little laminated cards, or the students can create them themselves. And it might just be, you know, moving arms up, arms down, one arm up, turning your head, where the kids can choose what order they want to do those steps in, and they're essentially putting together an algorithm to create a dance. They're doing a set of instructions, and their solution at the end is to have a dance. And it might be something that the kids like to act it out themselves. I've done this with kids, with students at schools, where they love to get up out of their seat and challenge each other to do a really fun dance. And they're always wanting to add some interesting dance moves, certainly ones that when not around when I was a kid. Adding music, always fun. So it really builds on that idea of what they're already doing. You can see I've got the dancing Lego there. So there's the opportunity there where students can have their little Lego man and be able to manipulate the character to actually be able to do the arms, do the head. And of course, you know, the Lego movies have lots of inspiration there of how the Lego moves in those very specific movements and how it can be built on in that way. I've also, with students, we've made a puppet, and you can just feel with you know, like the flip pins, they have all the different parts and they make their paper puppet, and then they can change the shape of the movements with that puppet and how it might then, you know, something that they can have, something concrete, something that they can keep, they can take home, and something that they've actually created to be able to actually write and act out their algorithm. This one's fun, is KidBots, You the Robot. When we have, even when, you know, if I mention, you know, a device, for example, something like a BeeBot, since I find little people, the early year students still often get confused just with that turning mode. The idea of, you know, that the robot will just turn on its own. So we always act it out first. We stand up and we just give instructions, and you can choose students to give an instruction, might be move forward or it might be turn. And I find that that really just clicks. They get that aha moment when they think, oh, okay, now I understand what that turning does. And so it's You the Robot. We'll often pair up and the students can, you know, be the programmer and tell their partner the instructions so that they act it out. And it's quite valuable for both of them to see whether they have success with that program that they create or whether it's something that they need to perhaps debug and say, well, you didn't do what I thought you were going to do. This one here, number three, writing instructions on how to play a game. So here we're building on complexity in what the students might be required to do. So students can actually create their own game and write out the steps on how to play. And it might be something as simple as, you know, like a math game, how to solve a problem in math, a multiplication game, a sight words game, as students are learning those sight words, what might be a game that you can play to do that? Well, tell me, how might you play it? And then they're giving those list of instructions, and it's essentially rules. And that I, very early on, introducing that idea of a loop. Well, what happens if it doesn't do what you want? Well, you go back to the beginning and then you have to try it again. Another little look at algorithms here. I love the idea of using picture books, well-known stories. And I know a lot of teachers have really taken this on board. And of course, one of our project officers, Celia, has really explored this concept a lot with looking at algorithms in our stories. One of my favorites is We're Going on a Bear Hunt. We read the story together as a class. I've, you know, got the big size book and you can read the story and really talk about where they went, so they have that visual idea of where they went on their bear hunt. And then we really talk about what was the order that they went in. And then, of course, when the bear, when they meet the bear in the cave, they then go back through those steps. So one way of doing algorithms in this, or looking at programming and a set of instructions with picture books, is reading the story and even just talking about and saying, well, what was the next step? Where did they go next? But you can take to the next step where you can have a worksheet with a grid and the pictures of those scenes or those events, and students write or draw an arrow to show where they might go on that bear hunt, or on Rosie's walk, or in what order did the big bad wolf go to go and visit the pigs at all the various houses, and that idea of, well, what happened when he huffed and puffed? Oh, well, the result was that the house blew down. So it's that idea of, if he huffed and puffed in a straw house, then the house will fall down. So it's that early introduction of the if and then statements. Hungry caterpillar, always fine. You can go and visit the food and just have cutouts or laminated sheets of all these different pieces, sort of showing a way of how might we arrange these, what order did they go in, well, what happened if they went in a different order, would that change the story, how might it affect the end result or that end solution or the resolution at the end of the story. So I've done that with students before where we draw the arrows on a worksheet in the graph. And then if you do have access to, you know, even just something like BeeBots or Simple Robots, we then printed out like little laminated cards of each of those events, and the kids can choose to put them all around on the floor, and then they can program their robot to go around. So it's sort of introducing the concept unplugged to something that they're quite familiar with, and oh, I know this story, and oh, I know the order that we do these things in, and I know what will happen if, you know, we find the bear, then we go back through. I know what happens if the hungry caterpillar eats all that junk food while he feels sick, so then he has a leaf. And so the students can actually build on that concept that they've got if you then want to turn it into an extension with a plugged activity. I also like it if students then want to write their own story. In a lot of ways, they're sort of like an adventure story, a character going from place to place to place. So the students can actually then write their own story, and it can be built on in like that flowchart kind of concept, or they can have little strips of paper where they line it up and mix them up and ask their friend to come and have a look and say, oh, you know, what might happen if we change that around? How does it change the story? So there's loads and loads of opportunities with using picture books or storybooks with those algorithms, and just introducing that language as well. So here I've shown another key concept here where we look at digital systems. So this is again a screenshot out of the Australian Computing Academy, which shows the progression of how students start to explore digital systems in hardware and software and what they're used for, building up into that idea of, well, what happens to the data? Where does it go? How does it get there? What might it look like? What does the network actually look like when the data is traveling through? Is it in a packet of information? Is it in what sort of language? So to explore this concept in something that really is, you know, the picture even shows that it's something wired, but we have opportunities here where we can look at this in such a different way. So the image that I have here is one from Hello Ruby, which they are a collection of books, three books. You may or may not be familiar with them. If you're not, I highly recommend going and visiting the Hello Ruby website and having a little look. It's, the idea of it is that it's this whimsical way of looking at what computers do, what does it mean to use a computer, how might we use a computer in a different way. And it's, the stories are lovely. The students that I have read them to have really enjoyed that idea of going into a computer and going on an adventure. So this first idea here, the idea of using fun craft activities. Everyone loves a bit of craft. So you just have a collection of craft there. It might just be string, paper arrows, so you can cut out the different arrows, or the students can cut it out into various shapes. Boxes, drag out, you know, all your recycling, take it along to school, and the students can actually cut it out and use coloured pens and create their own robot, or they can create a computer and make those different parts. You can see even in the example, in the Hello Ruby picture, is like the idea of like a little printer, which is on the far right hand side, the little yellow and the little piece of paper that just goes through and, oh, that's the printer or that's the scanner. So students get really creative with this. And they're building in on that idea of looking at input and output of those devices, and also looking at those peripherals, which we start to introduce really quite early with students, and even just the language. Oh, what does peripheral mean? Oh, you know, this is what we can do, and let's build a computer out of our crafting gear, and we can make it here so that students can see what it's all about. So highly recommend that. It's quite fun. This one here, if you're into students acting out the role of particular concepts, they could do it in like a small group or in a whole group or just in pairs, where the students take on that role of being a packet of information, and where might they go in a digital system to actually have that information delivered. So that idea of, well, how did the information go in? Is it through a microphone? And they can hold up the paper microphone. No, oh, I'm at the paper microphone now, and I've gone into the computer, and where do I go now? And how does that get transmitted through the computer, and then perhaps goes on an adventure out through an output device like a speaker? So a cool way of doing it there if students like to act it out. The third one there, so this idea of students could just write a story or do a picture book or a comic or a storyboard of how an email is delivered from one device to another and how that actually happens and what has to happen, where does it go, how is it transmitted, how is that information magically going through the air to another computer. And you can add the added element of perhaps adding in an attachment. What might happen if you then add an attachment? You know, these days we have so many options of signing documents just on our phone and then flicking them straight back out in an attachment in the email. So just beginning to understand that concept of what actually happens to it, where does it go? And I mentioned here, using recycled and craft materials. Apologies about the image blocking that text there, but it just says to create or build a model of the internet. So say, what do you think the internet looks like? I've asked my own children, you saw one up here earlier, you know, what is the internet? What do you think it is? Where does it go? Where does it live? What does it do? And so students can draw it if they want to, or they can build it, and really exploring that concept of this is an entire digital system, but so far we haven't even touched a computer, we haven't needed a robotic device, we haven't needed to be connected to the internet. We've just explored what that actually means and introducing that key language for students and what that actually means. So the idea is that they then progress and really build on that understanding through these, I like the word, whimsical ways of looking at the digital technologies curriculum. Okay, some thinking. What I thought we could do is look at a couple of examples of how we can have essentially like a plugged activity. So an activity that's using a digital device or a computer app or a game, and how might we turn it into an unplugged activity? So for example, students looking at user interfaces. So what does the game look like? So they could look at it. So, you know, if you've got access to computers and iPads, that's the thing. So saying, well, what does it actually look like? What does that video game look like? Is it easy to navigate? Is it easy to see how to add friends or to move around? How do you do that? How do you change what you're wearing? How do you change what your avatar looks like? Also looking at apps on tablets and saying, well, how do you know how to use it? You know, is it, do you just sort of tap until you see it, or do you, is it quite intuitive in what it looks like? So explain to students like what it looks like, the interface is how it helps you be able to use it. Of course, coding programs such as Scratch, great examples of looking at those specific features that make it so successful. Why is it so successful? Why do kids and adults alike like using it? And what students can then do, and as a whole class have the opportunity to create that criteria for success of digital solutions. So that's sort of, you know, the curriculum packet to say what makes it successful. Let's as a class come together and say, well, let's pick 5 or 7 or 10 criteria to say, well, what makes it successful? Is it nice use of colour? Is it a clever avatar? Is it a cool concept? So we can look at examples in that plugged in or digital format. And then students can create their own game at scratch.mit.edu, focusing on that criteria for success. So they're now making a game. They might make something, like I mentioned, a little math game, you know, practicing your timetables or learning your timetables, what ways you can remember it. So you can create that game in a plugged environment. So if that's our idea, you think, great, but how can I also explore user interfaces and build a criteria of success of solutions in an unplugged activity? So I'm just going to pull up my chat so I can have a little look. So if you have some ideas, please feel free to pop them into the chat window and let us know how might you turn something that is a plugged activity into something that is unplugged, essentially. Any ideas? Don't be shy. Perhaps looking at, I think this is something that quite a few people, I think, revisited this year is the good old board games. Certainly they had sold out of all of the stores during those isolation and lockdown periods. So something like Monopoly or Snakes and Ladders. Sorry, I was just reading the chat. Yeah, so something like Monopoly or Snakes and Ladders, and looking at what is the user interface in that? Why do I still remember them from my childhood? So students already know how to say. Yeah, absolutely. You could write the steps of the procedure. So procedural text, big one, particularly in that first term in the year, quite often students looking at those procedural texts. Aligning with a story like a favourite in our house, like George's Marvelous Medicine, and how it's that if and then concept of, well, if George adds this to the medicine, what might happen to grandma in that idea. Yeah, love it. So a literacy activity. And yeah, so as I was saying, even just like looking at normal games like Monopoly. So that idea of a loop, you know, if you land on a chance card, for example, and then you end up in jail, what are the rules involved in that? And how do you know that? And it's, you know, you're always reading the instructions in the book to say, oh, how might we play this game? Oh, what happens with this scenario? So it's that idea of if and then. And it's that interface, it's colourful and, you know, with snakes and ladders, it's that cool idea of, oh, you slide down a snake and I want to really climb up the ladder, but I know I need to roll this particular number. Absolutely. Jigsaw. Great idea. Another thing that interestingly sold out in a lot of shops over this year, certainly, sorting that the pieces and, doing your edge pieces first or your corners, how might you match it together? Yeah, love it. And a lot of the time this is stuff, this is equipment that we have either floating around in the classroom or at home, and probably things that the kids are really quite familiar with already. So love it, thumbs up to that one, good job. So another example here, looking at visual programming. So I mentioned Scratch before, but looking at block coding such as Scratch or hopscotch and pencil code and a lot of what we do, how might we turn that very digital activity into something unplugged without using a device? And yes, Celia, I love Guess Who. It was a good one. So this is something we explored earlier in today's session, was looking at algorithms and visual programming in unplugged ways. And classic one of asking students, particularly little people, preps, year ones, year twos, and asking them to write the order of steps of brushing their teeth. And there's some lovely videos available on YouTube to get that inspiration. But, asking kids, just write those steps of how you might brush your teeth. And also, how do you choose what you're packing in your lunch? Is it, are you helping? Oh, we need to make sure we're packing something healthy, and how might we go about doing that? Do we have a range of colour? How are we arranging that in our lunchbox? Good one, Celia. Dance moves on a card. I'm always a fan of doing the dance moves, and that idea of a repeat. So step left three times as opposed to having three separate blocks. Yeah, I love it. So there's some great ideas. And as you mentioned earlier too, about the procedural text in literacy activity, is putting in those flow charts of, what's the next step? What do we need to do? What happens, even in a recipe, what happens if you change one ingredient? I don't know that one. But yes, most games I think that you play at home can be adapted for something in the classroom, so kids have that fun, engaging way of learning about programming and algorithms in that unplugged way, as I mentioned, to really build on the concept, so they can then start to build onto something far more abstract when they start to get to the specific coding language. Very nice. So now that we've explored quite a few ideas here. There are loads and loads of resources available to find out more. I wish we could go into all of them, but there's lots of stuff available starting with our very own CSER resources that we have available. I went through them briefly at the start, particularly talking about that lending library. So if you would like to plug into something digital, there is definitely stuff available. Thank you, Lauren's just popped the link into the chat window. So feel free to save that one if you haven't been familiar with that previously. And of course, those MOOCs that we have are amazing. They just have a range of examples of both plugged, I guess, and unplugged teaching and learning ideas, a really good starting place. And I often see teachers building on that and saying, oh, I saw this, but now I can take this further and I can really build on that idea even further. A very exciting cybersecurity and awareness MOOCs that have just come out in the last few months. So really engaging in that idea of how students can work and learn safely online. So, so important. So great resource there. So we have a primary and a secondary one available there. To direct you to some of the resources that I used in today's session, so there's CS Unplugged, I think the name says it all, so that's Computer Science Unplugged. All free material available, lots of games, puzzles, and as it said, running around, and I'm a big fan of that, or getting up out of your seat and learning in lots of different ways. Thank you, Lauren. Pop some more, pop the links straight in the chat window for you there. Code.org, so while a lot of that is resources that you use online in the computer, there are a really great range of unplugged ideas there. The beautiful Hello Ruby collection there, and that's a direct link to take you into some teaching activities and ideas. And the Australian Computing Academy, where I unpacked that curriculum and pulled out those screenshots, really great place to start to really get some of those ideas there. These are our MOOCs, as I said, that are available. Highly recommend, even if you haven't done them before, starting at that foundation to six. I'm sure you really get an excellent grasp on what this digital technologies curriculum actually means and some beautiful ideas of how that can be incorporated directly into the classroom. I didn't mention before, sorry, that teaching AI in the classroom, also very exciting. It seems to be the up and coming concept of, you know, machine and artificial intelligence and how we can incorporate that into the classroom so students are learning about it and understanding what can be done and the potential with that. I would like to invite you to give some feedback. So we do have a feedback form. Lauren will pop the link into the chat window shortly. So please feel free to give some feedback about the session. I'll be putting together a one-pager or like a resource to go alongside this webinar recording, which will be available through our YouTube channel. And I will put together just some of those ideas. So it's something that if you are working in a school that you can take alongside, or I saw some familiar faces there of working with pre-service teachers, so how they might incorporate that straight into the classroom and learning those ideas straight up. Thank you, that link is in there. So I would like to thank you all for this session, and we will just stop the recording now and